here, the Linaro Connect Budapest 2017. And who are you?
Hi, I'm Andrea Gallo. I'm managing the segment groups at Linaro.
You're managing the segment groups. What does that mean?
It means that my role, the title is VP of the segment groups, and the role is make sure that the groups are delivering value to the members in each group. So this is the LEG, LNG, LMG, LHG, and light. So the groups working on servers, networking, mobile, digital home, and of course the Internet of Things and embedded.
So you're managing all the groups.
So I'm managing the groups. So this means that my role is to make sure that the directors of each group have all the means to work and are delivering value to the members. At the same time, I have a background role in making sure that the engineering teams and the directors and the project managers, they work in an aligned way across them all. And so I have a role on operational side, making sure that they work in an aligned way according to the way of working, the process that we have at Linaro, the reporting mechanism, the measurements, the KPIs. And I also have another role that is breaking the silos. When you have segment groups with different members and different product perspectives, it is too easy to end up into silos. So servers versus mobile or servers versus networking, it's too easy to look into your own silos, or mobile and digital home. It's easy to end up in your own silos, and my role is to break the silos, to make sure that there's no waste of effort, no duplication of activity, that we are using the resources and the fundings from our members at best. So if there's any overlap, it's my duty to go there and remove the overlap and make sure that the overlap turns into synergy.
So you're optimizing just like an ARM chip, right? You're optimizing the performance and the power consumption, which is also money, right? So everybody happy and things better.
Well, I would say that it's a lot of background work, lots of... There are phases when I feel that I'm having an impact, when I'm helping align the priorities and the vision of different groups. So that is where I feel that I have an impact. These are the phases that I enjoy the most. There are other phases of my working days or weeks or months. There are other phases where I'm more in a monitoring and reporting phase rather than having a direct impact. Well, my boss is not hearing. But those are more the boring phases when I'm overseeing and the directors are doing such a great job that I don't need to have a direct impact in those days. So
you need to have a great overview of everything, kind of, right?
Yes.
How long have you been working with the ARM stuff? You've been doing stuff with ARM for a while, right?
ARM, my very first interaction with ARM is even before ARM Limited existed. When I was a kid, I was writing assembly, small games, and those listings that folks who now start having some gray hair may remember is when we were typing listings from magazines. There was no internet. We were just copying from magazines. So I was initially copying and playing games written in assembly for the Sinclair Spectrum. And then I learned from that and I started writing my own games. So I became a contributor to one of these magazines.
You a game developer?
No, I would not say that. I had the ambition, but maybe I not reached that. But I was writing a lot of software, even in assembly, even overwriting the ROM code and the extending the basic interpreter of the Spectrum.
Or writing, Spectrum, right?
That was the Z80 on a Spectrum. Yeah. And I was writing also routines for graphics. That, by the way, this week we had a bird of a feather on graphics, embedded graphics. I love that. I love prepared for that both, because it just reminded me of when I was 12, 13 years old.
So they're talking about graphics on Cortex M?
Cortex M. And
which is the same kind of graphics that were back then.
It reminded me of what I was playing with when I was a kid. And then through that work, in 1986, there was Acorn in Cambridge, and it got acquired by Olivetti. And Olivetti is a PC manufacturer in Italy.
So coming from that?
So when I was a kid, I was 17 years old, and I had already been writing articles in assembly, in BASIC, every month for a magazine in Italy. I applied for summer job, and Olivetti introduced me to Acorn. So I was so lucky and honored to be a summer job student in Cambridge in 1987, and then again 1988. And 1987 is when Acorn introduced, announced to the world the very first Archimedes. It was designed on the very first ARM chip. It was the ARM 2 chip. The ARM 1 was a prototype, I think it started in 1984, 85. And the ARM 2 was the first one that went into production. So in 1987, I was there in Cambridge during summertime as a student, as a trainee.
Like a Google Summer of Code?
Kind of. Those days, there was this wonderful desktop machine, the Archimedes. And the BBC Micro was the most deployed in UK in schools, and moving to the Archimedes was a big change. So as a student, as a trainee, as a student with the ambition of becoming a software engineer, I had the task of testing tens and tens of educational software from the BBC on the Archimedes, identifying if they would run natively, if they required an emulator, if there were code to be fixed. So that was the work my task as a trainee in Acorn that was going to become ARM. And as part of that, I'll never forget, I had the honor of meeting Sophie, which you interviewed some time ago, Sophie Wilson. I can't remember exactly what I needed for some of those tests, the compatibility tests that I had to run on, but she volunteered to help me. So I had to go and see her in the secured area, because I was working.
Secure area.
It was a secured area. It was at the old building.
The secret R&D center.
At Acorn in Cambridge, it was in Fulbourn Road, and it was very different from the beautiful headquarters that are today. So anyway, from I was more in the public area. I had a badge access, but it was more the public area. And to get and go and see Sophie, there was a different level of security, a different badge needed. So she came to the doors.
Fingerprint scanner?
No.
Iris? No need?
Okay. No, but she came to see me at the gate, and we went to her office. And it was a very narrow but long office in a U-shape. And she had desks on the three sides, and she had five or seven Archimedes. And she was working on all at the same time, and I don't know if I needed a specific floppy drive or something that she could help me with. But as I was there, she gave me a demonstration of some of the advanced technology that she was working with. And that was 1987 or 88, either one. But she demonstrated to me drag and drop with a mouse on the Archimedes, on the ARM2 processor, there was the filer, there were two windows with a list of files and icons, and just with the mouse she selected multiple files from one folder and drag and drop into another one. That was, to me, it was the world first.
World first?
To me, yes. You had two windows with file, with list, what today is common, right? Two windows, copying from one into the other with drag and drop. And it was written in BBC Basic, 1987 or 1988. Now I'm not sure about the exact year. But
let's walk over here. Let's go down here. Yeah. Sorry. Yeah. So did she help you fix everything?
So, and the other thing that she demonstrated was the mailbox application. There was this taskbar with the mail. The icon was the British red mailbox. And when there were incoming emails, the mailbox was getting fatter because there were more mails, envelopes in the box. So that was fantastic, 1987.
And you said you had some issues. Did she was she able to help you with those? Did she fix them in, like, pretty quickly?
They were extremely minor, and frankly, I can't remember what the exact issue is. I have a vivid memory. Vivid memory of when I was in the office, and she demonstrated, oh, by the way, do you want to have a look at the new things we are working on? And demonstrated these things. For that, I have a vivid memory, as if it was 5 minutes ago. I'll never forget that. But what the issue I had, which was not working, sorry, that doesn't matter. I can't remember that.
Let's stand right here. Did you have a feeling that ARM was going to take over the world like this? Were you thinking, oh, I'm working on something that's crazy important?
At the time, it was educational PC computers for schools, so for sure important. But nobody in 1987 or 88 was thinking that the ARM processor was going to rule the world and be everywhere in all embedded devices and all appliances.
You had no idea.
And 1987 or 88, the ARM processor was mainly for the educational market.
But is it luck, or was the team just like crazy brilliant and fantastic and nobody else was as good?
They were... Sophie was just visionary and amazingly brilliant, for sure, for sure. Did something that was so revolutionary for the time and flexible. I think that the fact that then the educational market did not work out, and then Acorn went in bad shape, I think that was much more than blessing in disguise, much more. My feeling is that if Acorn succeeded in schools, I don't know, maybe they would have never looked into other markets, while by the fact that the educational market, the nationally protected educational market, without competition, that was collapsing, and Acorn was getting in financial constraints, that pushed everybody at Acorn to look at different opportunities. And that's when they started looking into telecom, into the rise of consumer electronics, and that's when they changed model, and instead of designing the ARM chip for their own exclusive internal consumption, they thought about this revolutionary business model that is licensing. I think that is where things changed, because the educational market was not successful.
So since that time, were you always working with ARM the whole time? Since 1986, 77?
Well, no. First, I had to go back and do all my university studies.
In Milan?
So I was in Rome.
In Rome.
I studied engineering university. Telco engineering. After my graduation, I was lucky to go to France, to ST Microelectronics in France, for a few months as a stagiaire. And after a few months, I got hired. So In the end, I spent 4 years in France, in ST Micro in France, working on telco. Part of the smartphones, well, at the time they were not smartphones, but they were mobile phones, and telco in terms of the 8 dial-up modems. Dial-up modems, we did a lot of work on optimizing software and hardware together. Then we started working on ADSL. So I moved from France to Italy, to Milan, ST Microelectronics in Milan, and that was ADSL, and we did a lot of great work, great fun, and...
So you've been involved in lots of stuff.
And then so it was on the boundary of between telco and phones, and set-top boxes at the time, and then smartphones, application processors. So we have been through the application processor efforts, Symbian. We looked at Linux, of course, a lot, starting from 2003. We started looking at Linux with the application processors, and we worked a lot on trying to have products in MIMO. And of course Android. So I did set up a team in Bangalore for STMicro, and where we were doing the we achieved the first Android port for STMicroelectronics application processor, which had one of the first hardware video decoding accelerations in Android. That was, I can't remember anymore, maybe it was 2004. So and then in 2010, let's just move far ahead. 2010, I was with ST Ericsson at the very first meeting at the Mobile Congress, February 2010, when Rob Coombs and Dave Rasling came to see the execs at ST Microelectronics, ST Ericsson, about these consortium to foster Linux on ARM. And I was pulled into this meeting. Please come here.
Come and listen.
And after the meeting, we were saying, what is ARM thinking? What is this crazy idea of silicon vendors who are competing fiercely? How can ARM think that we are going to sit in the same room and collaborate? And that was February 2010. Linaro was founded in June 2010 officially, and I joined Linaro as the technical representative from ST Ericsson, ST Micro in the Linaro technical board. And I figured out that their idea was really good and it was working really well. And this is all thanks to the technical leadership of Dave Rasling, who was really made competing companies collaborate so well in the Linaro model.
So you've always been involved with software and not the hardware chip design, right? Or is it related?
Back at ST, I was on the boundary of the architecture to optimize software and hardware together. That can be ADSL modems, that can be smartphones, so the boundaries between the software algorithms and the hardware accelerators. So the boundary, how to have a hardware architecture that is not designed by the hardware folks, as it was in the old days of the ASICs, that was the most exciting part to me when I was at ST, looking at how to provide input to the hardware folks to have the best hardware architecture that allows the software to run in the most optimized way.
Do you have this feeling that this is making a big difference, right? Linaro is a big deal. I mean, there's Linaro's contribution in everything in the world already, right? It's just there. Everything is Linux on ARM, no?
It is, and Linaro, I think we are extremely successful. I know that sometimes prospective members or members in the renewal phase, they go in through a very painful exercise of measuring the ROI. And I did it as well. When I was still at ST, and ST had to renew in 2012. I did go through an ROI analysis, trying to understand how much ST was paying, putting into Linaro, how much was getting. And I did that exercise at the time, and I came up with 3.5 or 3.6 times the return compared to what you were investing. But anyway,
it's hard to measure.
It's hard to measure. Well, you can. It's a painful process because if you want to be thorough as an accountant, you have to go through all the work items that we log into Jira, and you need to look and have an estimate of the man-month effort and estimate if you had it done internally. But that's an accountant's work, like an accountant doing the P&L, the certifying bookkeeping. But there's so much more in Linaro that is the strategic vision, it's the knowledge. Some members used to tell us that even if the return is just one, for them is a huge value, because there's so much that they don't measure, they cannot measure, but that is related to having Linaro hire the maintainers.
It influences the roadmap, I would guess. For all these companies, the roadmap would be totally different. It enables new technologies.
So there's the boring ROI for the account as accountants. Yeah. There's the knowledge, there's the maintainers, and there's even more that may not be measurable. Some members now come and tell us, why should we renew with Linaro if we are working with SOCs whose software is upstream? We just go upstream and take the software. And my reply to them is, what you are stating is the best evidence that we have succeeded. Because years before, they were investing in us to get that code upstream, and those frameworks, power management frameworks, the DBFS on ARM, we could spend hours in listing all the examples, but the fact that now OEMs can go on the internet and download a set of code that runs for some SOC, that's the best evidence that we have succeeded in using the money from these SOC vendors at best, because we have really accomplished what the primary mission is, improve the maturity of Linux on ARM and the availability of upstream. And it's not a one-off, because then there are new SOCs coming and improved frameworks, more complex frameworks. Look at everything that we are doing in all the segment groups is so complex and leading edge that we accomplish phases, and then there are new phases that are even more challenging. And so the renewals are all based on looking what we have accomplished, but with a strategic view on what they will need and what we will accomplish together in the next years. So I understand there is an accounting exercise, but we need also the strategic vision, and we need to look at what we have accomplished and what we will accomplish together in the coming months. And whenever a member is telling us, I've accomplished it, it's available upstream, I don't need you, I said, no. The fact that it's available upstream, it's the best evidence that we have used your contribution into Linaro at best, because we have achieved that. If that code was not available upstream, and you would still need to be with us for all products, that would be a lock-in. That would not adding value, that would be locking you in. And this is not what we want. We want to prove that we continue adding value. So we complete a phase. Phase is completed. You may not need Linaro anymore for that phase, but there's a new phase, and we will be successful in the new phase as well. So,
but the industry is moving so fast. There's this huge consolidation. Like one company is buying another, and another one is buying.
Yes,
them,
and then there are new companies
so
coming
moving.
Up. Things are moving fast.
So
but
of course
the
they have
to,
sometimes they have some companies were making tablets, and suddenly there's no more tablets. So it goes
yes,
very
and
fast.
Yes, and then there's something else. There's servers. There's HP high performance computing. There's on the networking side. Now we're looking at virtual CPE, edge devices. There's IoT. There's gateways. There's Because it's huge.
5G is going to be on par. There's no way we can have 5G without on par.
It's huge.
Even LTE is going to be on. Everything has to, and is already.
The keynote by Bjorn Ekelund here at Connect was so fascinating. It was. I invite you to go and, well, please do post the link in this page, the link to that keynote, because that was so fascinating. I've known Bjorn for so many years, and he's so good, and he was so inspiring to the engineers, because we have engineers working on RTOS, on embedded, and Bjorn was inspiring them, telling them, look, this is how your work will be used. This is how you impact. And he was talking about things that are changing our society. It's disruptive changes for our society.
He was there in the beginning of Linaro also, right?
Bjorn was instrumental when Nes Ericsson joined Linaro, correct.
And so it's open source software. Is it true or not that ARM is kind of like an open source CPU thing? Because it's not really open source, but kind of like a... there is some parallel here, right? And the whole thing is just, if you have lots of collaboration, lots of companies, everybody innovating every corner that they want, the market grows much faster.
It's an interesting thing that you are sharing. In a way, the fact that the business model that silicon vendors can license the ARM core
for small fee
and add their own differentiating IPs or even license the architecture and design their own implementation, it accelerates the rate of development and innovation.
It sounds
absolutely
similar to,
yes,
Linaro. So what you're doing,
well, then don't go up to open source versus open hardware, because of course the designing an SoC is so expensive that of course the ARM licenses, it cannot be free because there's so much investment behind. I think we should not go too far, but it's a fascinating.
But you're definitely making a difference in what's going on right now in the world. This is a big deal right now. We need 1 trillion chips, right? 1 trillion ARM chips.
Yes.
And they're all gonna run
open
source,
yes,
software.
Yes, absolutely. You're right.
Cool.